So we've got our came to Eric in a dream board over here. That's actually literally true. It's really funny. I can't remember if I told that story or not, but he dreamed about having one of these, and we're like, yeah, let's do that. So we've got the takeaway point from each of the sermons. We'll continue to update it as the series goes on. So we're in this Todd's Tips for Politics series, as Eric dubbed it, and I think that's a good name, that has two purposes. We're trying to talk about the stories of Ezra and Nehemiah, but we're also trying to show how those stories can weigh in on what might be going on in our political situation right now, the elections. The first week was just this giant, massive, in parentheses, disclaimer. Like, all I did was just talk to you about what I don't want to talk to you about. Like, don't worry. I and the church are not interested in telling you who and what to vote for. That's not the function at all. Just trying to talk about how you approach politics in general. And the thing that you really need to do, the thing I will tell you that you have to do, is you have to relax. Like, it's gonna be okay. You know, like, God's got this under control. And that was the whole first week. Like, God has proven capable of running the world. It's gonna be fine. So we all collectively took a deep breath, and then we moved on and talked about Ezra, and we saw in the life and character of Ezra, all that dude ever did was pray about stuff. He just prayed, and then he prayed, and things happened and materialized around him, and he was faithful in prayer, and it worked out. And I think that that's an encouragement to us as we're the royal priesthood and the holy nation, much like Ezra. We pray for our government that things will go according to God's plan, not according to my plan or according to my candidate's plan, but according to what God wants. And then if we, like Nehemiah, are motivated to action, or if we are in positions where we can actually affect change, which frankly not many of us are, but if we do find ourselves in positions where we can actually affect change, maybe on a national scale, maybe on a local scale in our government, then we need to make sure that we're taking the right actions based on the prayer that we're praying as the royal priesthood and the holy nation. Right, which leads us up to today. We're at a really interesting point in the story where we're in an Ezra and Nehemiah series, and we're not talking about Ezra or Nehemiah, which I like. That kind of stuff hypes me up too. So if you would please turn to Jeremiah chapter 29. And while you're turning there, I'll do my obligatory quick review. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Then slavery in Egypt. Then delivery from slavery. King Saul, David, and Solomon. Assyria conquers the northern kingdom. Babylon conquers Assyria and the southern kingdom. Exile. Right. Chain of events leading up to where we are now. And I have to keep doing that because this is in the long lost middle of our Bibles, and so this story is much less well known. Jeremiah chapter 29. You'll be looking for verse 10 when you get there. The book of Jeremiah has a lot to do with the disposition of God toward his people right before the exile. Right, they were very concerned about being conquered. And Jeremiah, the prophet, comes along and says, hey, everybody, it's fine. We're about to get conquered, but it's fine. He was not a popular guy, as you probably could imagine. So he predicts some things. He talks to the people about some things that are going to happen so that they can be comforted and reassured going into exile and what looks to be like returning to slavery that everyone is deeply concerned about, as you would be as well. So beginning in Jeremiah 29, verse 10. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and the places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. Okay? Clear expectations are being established. God is trying to communicate something very specific to Israel. This is a temporary situation. I am doing this for a purpose. You are going to get conquered and you are going to get exiled, but that will not be the end of your story. More is going to happen. Our story is going to continue. There will be more. And part of the more is this concept that we call the Messiah. Right? God's anointed. That's what Messiah means in Hebrew. Like the anointed one, the one that God will choose in order to fulfill the purpose. Like the capital T purpose, capital P, you know, like the purpose of restoring Israel, renewing the covenant, bringing the people into what we later find out to be the spiritual promised land, you know, like finally realizing all of the dreams that have been promised since Abraham. Like the capital M Messiah, the anointed one, is supposed to come and do that. That hope begins to spring up around this time as well. Because when things are generally going okay, you don't necessarily like have a hope for some idyllic future. It's like, yeah, this is kind of fine, you know, like whatever, it's no big deal. But around the time that they're about to get conquered, Isaiah and Jeremiah time, it becomes really obvious that they're going to need some kind of serious intervention. And the intervention that God promises is a Messiah. And the Messiah gets described in a lot of ways, but here are a couple from Isaiah chapter 9. For to us a child is born, and to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Then we see later in Isaiah, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. Right? Like the expectation of the Messiah is a restoration of the nation of Israel and the sins being forgiven. And what are the sins? The sins are all the obvious stuff, like throughout all of Israel's history. Israel has never been very good at being God's people. They've always failed at that. They own that. We own that. It's our history. It's okay. We continue to fail at being God's people. God will forget about all of that, all of the previous failings, and God will restore this Moses-like connection where there's no need for an intercessor and we're this royal priesthood and holy nation, right? Like this is the hope of the Messiah. All of this just gets prophesied about a ton during this era in Israelite history as they're being carried off into exile and as they're returning from exile. Okay, so we're up to speed on the story. We understand the expectation and the hope. They are carried off as slaves. They are expecting to return, and there's gonna be some guy who has the government on his shoulders, and he will be called a bunch of kingly titles like Wonderful Counselor and Prince of Peace and stuff. Got to hold on to that, okay? This is really important for today. That's going to be essentially the whole thing. But turn to Ezra chapter 3. And we're going to meet our heroes for today who are not Ezra and Nehemiah. Ezra was a teacher of the law. He's apparently pretty prominent because he was the guy who was selected to actually read the law during that big festival, the week-long festival where someone gets up and reads the law. He's the guy who does that, so he's apparently a pretty big deal. And Nehemiah was a cupbearer to the king, ends up functioning much like a diplomat between Persia and Israel or Judah. He oversees the construction of the walls in around Jerusalem. Oversees might be a little bit overstating there. He's just kind of involved and he helps create some strategy because he's kind of in and out. Like he goes back to Persia because he still is the cupbearer to the king the whole time. But these guys wrote the books. So like we get to hear about their experiences. And generally when you think about Ezra and Nehemiah as books, you think about the characters, Ezra and Nehemiah. But we're about to see something really interesting in Ezra chapter 3. When the seventh month came and the Israelites had settled in their towns, the people assembled together as one in Jerusalem. Then Joshua, son of Jozadak, and his fellow priest, and Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and his associates began to build the altar of God, of the God of Israel, to sacrifice burnt offerings on it, in accordance with what was written in the law of Moses, the man of God. So we meet our characters here. So we have Joshua, the high priest, and we have Zerubbabel, the governor. These are the guys that actually did all the stuff. Naming the books Ezra and Nehemiah is a little bit misleading. They're named after who wrote them. They're not named after the main characters, per se. Because the main movers and shakers at this moment in history are actually not Ezra and Nehemiah. These guys are really important characters. They perform incredibly important functions. But the high priest and the governor are the ones who seem to be executing all the work. You don't have to turn there, but we see in Ezra chapter 5, verse 1, now Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the prophet, a descendant of Edo, prophesied to the Jews in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel, who was over them. So we know Haggai and Zechariah were prophesying at the same time that Ezra and Nehemiah were conducting their business in Israel. As people are returning from exile, they're trying to rebuild the nation. And so I had, you know, of course you have to ask the question like, oh, okay, Joshua and Zerubbabel seem like pretty big deals. They seem like really important guys. Where would we go to find out about those guys? Well, now we know. Turn to Haggai chapter 1. It's page 934 in your pew Bibles. Actually, remember to look that up. Usually I just make you suffer and find it yourself or use the table of contents, but Haggai is getting into some minor prophet obscurity in the long lost middle, so I didn't want to wait for forever to have you find it. That's a quip, not a jab. There's a difference. The book of Haggai is about prophecies concerning the rebuilding of the temple. The prophet Haggai prophesies in Jerusalem about the temple. Like, that's this guy's shtick. He's got two chapters. It's not a huge book, but he does have some things to say about our new main characters, or rather our latest heroes, Joshua and Zerubbabel. Have you found Haggai? Chapter 1, beginning in verse 12. Then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the whole remnant of the people obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the message of the prophet Haggai, because the Lord their God had sent him. And the people feared the Lord. Then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave this message of the Lord to the people. I am with you, declares the Lord. So the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of the whole remnant of the people. They came and began to work on the house of the Lord Almighty, their God, and on the 24th day of the sixth month. So Joshua and Zerubbabel are the ones who actually do all the work. I'm not trying to undervalue Ezra and Nehemiah. Those guys are great. But they were not in position, the positions of prominence. Joshua is the high priest. Zerubbabel is the governor. These are the ones who actually did it. They actually executed the task. And in a sense, they're the real main characters of the story. But Ezra and Nehemiah wrote the books, so they get to talk about what they want to talk about. And I'm forced to ask as well, like, these guys are in positions of prominence, so how does God feel about them? Like, this would be a good question for us to answer if we're thinking about them as leaders. If you skip down to chapter 2 in Haggai, in verse 20, the word of the Lord came to Haggai a second time on the 24th day of the month. Tell Zerubbabel, governor of Judah, that I am going to shake the heavens and the earth. I will overturn royal thrones and shatter the power of the foreign kingdoms. I will overthrow chariots and their drivers, horses and their riders will fall, each by the sword of his brother. On that day, declares the Lord Almighty, I will take you, my servant Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, declares the Lord, and I will make you like my signet ring, for I have chosen you, declares the Lord Almighty. You know what a signet ring is? This might be important to go over just in case. A signet ring is a signature ring in the ancient world. Well, not so ancient world, in the preliterate world, which was not so long ago. If you were going to sign a document or seal a document closed, you would like drip wax on the seal, and then you would use your signet ring, which had a very particular crest or image or something on it, and you would kind of mash that gently into the wax, and then it would harden, and you'd pull your signet ring out, and you'd have this picture that represented your signature, like whatever that picture would be. I don't know, like a lion or a shield or whatever. And nobody else had a ring like this. It was a lot harder to forge things, you know, back in that day than it would be today. And so, like, you would just have your signet ring that you would sign things with. And it was really important for kings and court officials to have stuff like that, because they would send official mail and people would need to know that it actually came from them and that Todd didn't just write a letter and say, hey, give Todd all your stuff, you know? Like, if somebody were to say that, they would need to have a signature on it, and it would need to be sealed. It would need to come closed, so it was obvious that it wasn't tampered with. And the reason that it was a ring is so that you could keep it on your person at all times. You know, it's kind of like a wedding band. Because if it's just a stamp that you keep in your office, in the office drawer, someone can bust in there and steal it. But if it's a ring on your finger, it's pretty hard to steal that while you're sleeping or otherwise. Like, it's just here all the time. You wear your signet ring so that you can sign things and so that no one else can sign on your behalf. That's an interesting way to talk about a person when God is like, you are my signet ring. I am going to sign my name with you. And this is, of course, at the exact same time that we have some pretty strong messianic expectations, some pretty strong expectations that a Messiah is about to show up. And God is declaring, you will be my signet ring when stuff goes crazy. You know, when he says, when I will shatter the power of foreign kingdoms, you will be my signet ring. Interesting. Let's turn to Zechariah. Let's deal with Joshua before we go any farther. Zechariah is on page 940. No more quips. Just page number. And for any who may not know, Zechariah is kind of an odd book. It's not odd in that it's odd in the ancient world. It's odd to us because it has metaphors and images in it that are weird, like a woman in a basket. She gets in the basket lifts up in the air, and it flies away. That's kind of weird, and that's okay. But there's some odd images in there. Like Zechariah has some unusual metaphors. So like the way that God apparently communicates to or through Zechariah is through these unusual metaphors and images as opposed to Haggai, which was pretty clear. It's like, yeah, Haggai, you're like, tell him what to do and how to do it. And he went and told him what to do and how to do it. Zechariah gets a little different strategy. And so some of his images are a little bit different. They're strongly metaphorical, but they also have strongly literal implications for what's going on in the life of Israel and what God is doing and what's about to happen. So that's where we find ourselves in Zechariah chapter 3. We see one of these images. And he, right here, is going to be God. Then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right side to accuse him. The Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord, who has chosen Jerusalem, rebuke you. Is not this man a burning stick snatched from the fire? Now Joshua was dressed in filthy clothes as he stood before the angel. The angel said to those who were standing before him, take off his filthy clothes. Then he said to Joshua, see, I have taken away your sin, and I will put fine garments on you. Then I said, put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him while the angel of the Lord stood by. The angel of the Lord gave this charge to Joshua. This is what the Lord Almighty says. If you will walk in obedience to me and keep my requirements, then you will govern my house and have charge of my courts, and I will give you a place among these standing here. Okay, we're going to stop right there for the moment. Right, so the image, this is familiar to some of you who are at the Origins of the Doctrine of the Devil Sunday school class. That was a really interesting study, by the way. Plug myself a little bit there. Satan is the accuser, accusing the dirty, unclean high priest. This guy is now supposed to be the direct link, the representative, the high priest, the intermediary between all of Israel and God in the temple. Right, this guy's job is of fundamental importance to holiness and worship in the community. And so he is wearing these dirty, sin-stained clothes in the metaphor. And Satan is accusing him. Presumably, right, Satan is pointing out things that are true because his clothes are dirty and nasty. And the angel of the Lord or God is like, take off those dirty clothes. I am giving you clean clothes. And you are going to come into my house and you are going to serve in the way that I have authorized you to serve. And of course, all of the, you know, the undertones, the implications, like God is a God who forgives sins. You know, like this is an ongoing theme through all of Israel's history. God is a God who forgives sins. And this is no different. We're returning from exile. There is no one worthy to be the high priest. So God makes this Joshua worthy. God's like, I look around and I see there is no one worthy, but that's okay because I'm the kind of God who cleans people and who makes people worthy, not because of their merit, but because of who I am as God. And so he takes the dirty clothes and gives him clean clothes, forgiving the sin of the high priest. Now, for those of you who know your Jewish temple polity, you understand the implications here. If the high priest is clean, then so is the rest of Israel. Right? You track with me? The representative who goes and speaks on behalf of Israel to God and who hears from God on behalf of Israel has been made clean. And by extension, all of Israel has now been made clean, because that's how it works. Your high priest is your representative. And so God has done a mass forgiveness of sins, not unlike God promised he would do when the Messiah came. Right? You've seen the connections that I'm kind of heavy-handedly making here? Like, we're in a weird spot all of a sudden in Israel's history, right? Jesus hasn't happened yet. Put your back there, way back there, you know, around 500 or so BC, BCE, whatever, way back there. Jesus hasn't happened yet. We're waiting for the Messiah. We know the Messiah is going to have the government on his shoulders. We know that the coming of the Messiah is going to be accompanied by the forgiveness of sins, the restoration of the kingdom, maybe the rebuilding of the temple, all these things that are happening. We have a really small problem, though. There's two guys. Which one is the Messiah? Zerubbabel is God's signet ring, the chosen one to go and lead the nation of Israel, the restored nation of Israel. It must be him. We know that economic policy is more important than anything else. This is the guy responsible for that. He must be the Messiah. No. Ezra people, the high priest is the most important person. Clearly, it's the high priest. You know, this guy has been made clean. He's been anointed to be the high priest in the temple during a new golden age in Israelite history. Clearly, it must be the high priest. The high priest is going to be the Messiah. It's not a stretch. Right? You can see what I'm doing here. I'm taking the ways that these guys were talked about by prophets in their own era and showing how there could be some confusion. We have the benefit of history. We know what happens on the other side of all this, and that's okay, that's good. Right, but put yourselves in the mind of those Israelites. Future is uncertain. We're on our way back from exile, returned from slavery. Now we're gonna have a second Moses, one who is like Moses, who's gonna lead us into the promised land, who's gonna build the temple, who's gonna do all these things, gonna restore the nation of Israel. And we've got two guys, and they're apparently both anointed in different ways, and they are going to oversee these tasks. People thought they were the Messiahs. That happened. They thought that these guys were going to be one of them, maybe both of them somehow, that like this battery of high priest and governor were going to compose like the messianic age, like it's here. Just like God promised, we return from exile, the Messiah is here, like we're ready to go. How would you choose which one? The Messiah is always talked about in the singular, so it's got to be one of them. I wonder how you would choose. I wonder what kind of debates took place. I wonder what kind of shouting on the street corner took place. I wonder what kind of Facebook ads they saw. I wonder if there was campaigning for your guy. Yeah, clearly it's Zerubbabel. Look what he's done. He rebuilt the temple. He laid the foundations of the altar so that we could offer sacrifices. Yeah, but what about the guy offering the sacrifices? Like, isn't Joshua pretty important? Ah, there'd be no Joshua without Zerubbabel. Yeah, there'd be no Zerubbabel without Joshua. We need to be able to communicate to God. All this economic stuff, this is all because of Zerubbabel's brilliant, cunning economic strategy. Yeah, but none of that would be possible if God wasn't blessing it through our high priest Joshua. Like, who's your Messiah? Like, who's getting pulled back and forth? Like, I don't know. I don't know what to do. All I know is that it's got to be one of them. Clearly, one of them has to be the Messiah. This is my expectation. Everything is going to be made perfect. Those who thought that one of the two of them were the Messiah were wrong. We end up finding out later that the scope of the Messiah was so much bigger. than we ever imagined. Right? The person and character of Jesus perfectly captures government on his shoulders while he's offering forgiveness of sins. But we couldn't have known that beforehand. We couldn't have known how big it was going to be. You know, we couldn't have known what it was actually going to look like. What a confusing era. God is doing such wild things, radical things, wrenching us away from the promised land into slavery, putting us in time out, so to speak. And then we get pulled back, and God anoints people to do things and do specific things and take care of things and take care of us. And we get back with this expectation that a Messiah is coming. And we're like, which one is it? Like, how would I even know? There's so much turmoil. Everything seems so uncertain. I have no idea what to hope for. Everything seems so precarious. Right on the edge, about to tip over. At any moment, Persia could change their mind and come back and reclaim us. At any moment, one of these guys could get politically assassinated and we lose our Messiah. Right? At any moment, any of these things could happen. Joshua and Zerubbabel are it for us right now. We need them. We need to support them. We need to build up their reputation, their credibility, because they are our future. So I've told the story. Now it's time to transition into the Todd's Tips for Politics portion. Right, this is what I've done every time. I tell you a really fun and interesting story, or at least I think it's fun and interesting. Then I try and talk to you about how it might apply. I'm hoping you're getting a sense of where I'm about to go. Their hope should not have been found in Joshua or Zerubbabel. For those of you who may have read on in Zechariah, we're going to get some clarification in the verses immediately following where we stopped. And we'll pick up there next week, because we're not going to go quite that far this week. This week, we're talking about where our hope is not. And next week, we're talking about where our hope is. Their hope was not in Zerubbabel and Joshua. Their hope was in God, the God who brought them back, the God who made promises and followed through on them. I can't state it any clearer than this. Your hope is not in the presidential candidate. Your hope is in God. Everyone does the same thing. Those of you who've been around for a while, you've observed this trend. Those of us who have not been around as long have already observed it. Somebody gets up and says, I can fix things, just give me a chance to fix things. Somebody else stands up and says, I can fix things, but I'm going to do it differently. One of the two of them gets a shot to fix things. They get in there, they don't fix anything, and they blame everyone but themselves. And then we do it again. Different person stands up. No, I can fix things. I saw what they did wrong. I can do it better. And then a different person over here. No, I can fix things. And the volume escalates and it gets louder and louder with all these people promising that they have the answers to fix the situation. And then we elect one of them and we're like, finally, right? Like, we got them, the right person for the job. And then nothing gets fixed. And they blame everyone but themselves. It's the former president. It's the Senate majority, it's the this, it's the whatever. Like, this, tell me I'm not alone seeing this cycle. The volume is louder than I've ever heard it in my relatively short lifespan this year. I cannot believe how loud they're shouting to try and get us to hear them. And they're all claiming that they can fix it. You want to know the truth? The situation is unfixable. Right? Like, we have it pretty good in this country. And there's a lot of rhetoric about how terrible things are. That's not what I observe. I mean, I've got weird, unique problems that are specific to my generation. Talk to me about student loans sometime. Good Lord. But like, generally, things are pretty good. We're all worshiping here safely. You know, like, let's just remember where our hope goes. Let's not put our hope as if somebody is going to get in there and fix everything and figure it out and finally this person will be the right candidate or get us back on track or get us doing whatever thing that they're promising they're going to do. Maybe some of that stuff's going to work. I don't know. Just as much of it's not going to work, though. Like, we know that. We've seen history. But we talk about it with such definitiveness as if if I could just get my guy in there or my gal, all right, we can fix it. I hope that the right person gets elected, because they'll fix it. Fix what? Fix a broken world? Fix a broken government? Right, this whole thing is broken. That's why we're here. Right, because we believe that God has offered restoration. We believe that a day is coming when all authority will be laid down to Jesus and he will fix it. Right, we don't hope for the right candidate because we know there is no right candidate except for Jesus. I'm kind of stepping on next week's conclusions here a little bit, but I think you knew where I was going to go with that anyway. Right, I don't know who your candidate is. I don't care who your candidate is. They're not going to fix it. It's broken beyond repair for a person. Joshua and Zerubbabel did a lot of really good stuff. Like, their political program was strong. I mean, they set Israel up well, but they were still a vassal nation to Persia. They paid taxes through the nose to the point where they were not independent, but completely dependent on another nation. That's not exactly the picture of freedom that they were hoping for. Within a generation, they all forget all of the festivals. None of that stuff stuck. They go right back to all the same patterns they've always been in. Within a couple hundred years, they get conquered by Greece. Year 333. You know, and then not long after that, they get conquered again by Rome. You know, like, it did not fix anything. These guys did not fix anything. To hope in them was to waste hope, right? That's non-hope. We should not be hoping in a specific candidate who's going to fix everything. I mean, maybe you have one whose, you know, views or strategies or whatever aligns most with what you think and you vote for that person. Like, great, you know, like, do prayerfully decide what action to take and then take that action. You know, like, that's like Nehemiah it up. Great, I want you to do that. But don't forget, that's not your hope, right? If you would just describe that or classify that as being a responsible citizen or a responsible adult or person or whatever, however you talk about that, that's great. You know, like, I want you to like stick to your convictions and go with what you want to do, but don't put any hope there. There's no hope to be found there. And I'm going to tell you something that is probably going to make you radically uncomfortable and rock your world. And I know that, and I'm trying to be sensitive because I really care about you all, but I want you to know this. This is important. This is the first time that I'm naming like political parties and stuff like that. So I'm trying to be really sensitive. Okay, like, I respect all of you. I'm just trying to point something out that I've seen. In the Midwest, where we are, conservative politics tend to be the preference. And Christianity tends to go that route and vote Republican. I spent 2 years in LA where every faithful Christian that I knew voted Democrat, believing wholeheartedly that that was what Christ wants them to do. Like, faithful, believing, fruit-bearing Christians who represent Christ in ways that I admire and strive to do are voting the opposite way that most people who are here, whom I respect and who admire and bear fruit in ways that I aspire to bear fruit, vote. You're canceling each other out. Christians in one part of the country are canceling out Christians in the other part of the country. I just want you to know that. I don't know what you're going to do with that information. I just want you to be aware. In Southern California, to be a faithful believer is to care about justice issues and to vote liberal. Here, it's care about morality issues and vote conservative. You're canceling each other out. Remember that you should not put hope in a particular candidate. That's not where your hope is found. I know that can be jarring for some of you, and some of you are really like racking your brains, like, how could they possibly think that? What a lack of unfaithfulness. I have heard people say, people whom I respect, who I'm close to, say, I don't believe that you can be a Christian Democrat. You know what I heard when I was in LA? I'll just say it, you know, because it's obvious. Like, I don't believe you can be a Christian Republican. Faithful believers whose fruit I observed, right? This is why that week one, I told you, like, you come to me with your political views, I'm just going to take the opposite view and just be a thorn in your flesh, because you don't have the answers and neither do I. Right? We can't fix a thing that's broken beyond repair. It's broken. Be responsible. Do what you think is the responsible move. Vote how you're convicted to vote. I don't want to know. I don't care. Be faithful to the best you can be. But recognize that's not your hope. Describe it however you want to. Civic duty, responsibility, maturity, whatever. Describe it however you want, but you do not describe it as the hope, where your hope is found. That is not what we hope for. We hope for something else. And I'm going to talk about that next week. Let's pray. God, your workings are mysterious. We believe in you. We believe you're at work. We want to be a faithful people. Sometimes we don't know exactly what to do, but we trust that you're going to show us, and we trust that our effort will bring you glory. Help us to know what to do. Help us to represent Christ in all situations. Just make us hopelessly dependent on you, so we know that nothing good happens without you. Help us not to put our hopes in things that are fleeting and won't last, but instead to find our hope in you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.